Can you see me?
I can't either. All right, all right. Hello, you all, and welcome. I am Jillian Page, the creator and teacher of Meisner Music, for which tonight's recital is benefiting. It is that little logo, but we'll get into that a little more later. I am so overjoyed to welcome you to our recital of Frank Loesser's The Most Happy Fella, recital following the role of Rosabella. We have an incredible night ahead, some glorious music, a wildly talented cast, but before we get into it, I wanted to explain what it is we're doing here. So last year when the pandemic hit, I realized that I needed an artistic project to pour myself into so that I didn't lose it. And I figured it would be fun to learn one of my dream roles, Rosabella, in The Most Happy Fella, because if no one is casting, why not cast yourself? So on this day, a year ago exactly, June 5th, 2020, I received my used score of Frank Loesser's The Most Happy Fella. And learning the entirety of this role was more difficult than I had bargained for, as opposed to learning just a few of her main songs. I feel like learning a role is like falling in love. In the first few stages, you're like, this is wonderful, I can't get enough of this. And then a few months in, you start to think, what was I thinking? I need to get out of this somehow. And then as the year mark rolls around, you really start to think about everything that you've been through together and all the times that you've spent together. So as that time period came around with my Rosabella learning, I decided to put on this recital. I wrangled together some of my most talented friends, and I just can't wait for you all to see what we've been working on for these last several months. Now, before I introduce this beautiful cast, I'm gonna share some history and fun facts with you about the show that I just find fascinating. So The Most Happy Fella opened on May 3rd in 1956 at the Imperial Theater. The Imperial Theater most recently housed the revival of Carousel, so good, Natasha Pierre and the Great Comet of 1812, and will reopen in October, woo, with Ain't Too Proud. The Most Happy Fella was really well received when it came on the scene in 1956, boasting 6 Tony nominations and 676 performances. However, this 1956 season on Broadway was a doozy. It gave us Candide, Bells Are Ringing, but one huge competitor that really greatly overshadowed The Most Happy Fella. Can you think of what it was? My Fair Lady. I know, The Most Happy Fella's timing was unfortunate. It didn't win one of their 6 Tony nominations. My Fair Lady was up for 5 of the same nominations, won them all, and My Fair Lady went on to play 2,717 performances, lasting more than 4 times longer than Most Happy Fella's run. But it wasn't all in vain. Okay, The Most Happy Fella has gone on to be one of the most beloved, revived, and timeless musicals of all time. In fact, it was so good that it broke new ground as far as what we expect from original Broadway cast recordings. So back in 1956, an original Broadway cast recording was about 45 minutes and just highlighted some of the hit songs. But Columbia Records saw something really special in The Most Happy Fella, and they recorded a 3-album LP set that was 2.5 hours long and covered the entire show save for a few spoken lines. And this recording set the precedent for what we now expect from original Broadway cast recordings. All right, I have 3 more fun facts for you, and then we'll get into the meat of tonight's show. Fun fact number 1, there was an episode of I Love Lucy in which the Ricardos went to go see The Most Happy Fella. And the reason for this product placement was because Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz were original investors in that production of The Most Happy Fella, and they wanted people to go see it. Fun fact number two, you guys are gonna die. The Most Happy Fellow was supposed to be produced as a full-length Hollywood feature film in 1962. Many of you will remember that the 1960s were a booming time for musicals to be made into movies, and The Most Happy Fellow was gonna be one of them, starring Shirley Jones and Fred Astaire. But Shirley Jones got caught up making The Music Man, so then they brought in Natalie Wood to play Rosabella, and then she got booked doing Gypsy. So it never got made. Such a disappointment. I would have loved to have seen that. Our last fun fact is that Joe Sullivan, who originated the role of Rosabella, ended up falling in love with the show's composer, Frank Loesser, during this production, and they ended up getting married. Now, Joe said that when she got the part, there were really only three sopranos vying for Broadway roles: her, Barbara Cook, and Florence Henderson. Singers, can you imagine only two other people up for the same roles as you? I would die. Joe said of falling in love with Frank Loesser while working with him, "Well, you just couldn't work with Frank and not sort of fall in love with him. He was enchanting." So I would like to end our fun facts portion of tonight by listening to a clip of Joe Sullivan Loesser speaking with NPR in 2006 about her husband and his upholding of the importance of the lyric. Frank Loesser believed that yes, beautiful singing was great, but the truthful storytelling supported by the lyrics was the most important element of a performance. This clip concludes with a snippet of Frank Loesser himself singing some of his own beautiful lyrics.
I thought he sang terrific. I mean, let's face it, he didn't have a very beautiful voice, but he certainly knew how to put a lyric over. I mean, you could see how important the lyrics were to him. And I think it shows on this album. I think it's great fun to listen to.
No, me too. Well, let's hear it. This is Frank Loesser singing one of his songs from Guys and Dolls, "I'll Know."
I'll know when my love comes along. I'll know then and there. I'll know at the sight of her face. How I care, how I care, how I care. And I'll stop and I'll stare. And I'll know long before we can speak. I'll know in my heart. I'll know and I won't ever ask, am I right? Am I wise? Am I smart? But I'll stop and I'll stare at that face in the throng. Yes, I know when my love comes along.
Beautiful. And with that, let's introduce our cast. First, we have Esteban Suero playing Joe, a foreman whom the script describes as big and young and strong. Esteban is my dear friend from grad school at Oklahoma City University, and he was in my very first Miser in Music class, which was really just a group of my friends and I workshopping in Ripley Greer, wondering if this was anything. We are so blessed to have his talent with us tonight. Next, we have Carol Hardern playing Cleo, a waitress from Dallas. Carol and I take Miser from the same teacher, the fabulous Ted Wold, and Carol is currently in Miser Music. Just wait until you hear her voice. It is glorious, and so is she. Lastly, y'all, we are so fortunate to have Tony Triano playing the role of Tony, whom the script introduces as an exuberant Italian grape farmer. When I was going through my mental Rolodex of who could play the role of Tony, when Tony Triano came to mind, I could have fainted. I am so in love with Tony. You'll see me crying and falling in love with him in almost every scene. He is such a perfect Tony, and I can't wait for you all to witness his magic tonight. I would also like to shout out our accompanist, Kevin Smith, who recorded every single one of these tracks for us based on our preferred preferences with phrasing and pacing. This is altogether just such a dream cast, and I can't wait for you to see them throughout the show. So here's how tonight's gonna go. This recital only runs about an hour, so we won't be taking an intermission. If you need to go to the bathroom, I would suggest doing so now. A downloadable program may be found at jillianpage.com if you want to follow along with the show. And for those of you that may not know me as well, I created and teach an acting through song class called Meisner in Music. And Meisner is an acting technique that helps singers to not only trust in themselves, but find the joy of singing again that is unfortunately all too often lost amidst the pursuit of this career. You may also know this, but pursuing a career in the arts not only requires a ton of stamina, but a significant amount of privilege. The amount of money that you need for things like classes, nice audition clothes, the amount of non-paying gigs out there you might have to take, the stable support system you have to have is out of this world. And on top of that financial privilege, the artistic world has historically favored white, cisgendered, able-bodied, artists, throwing a severe disadvantage to BIPOC artists, performers of marginalized genders, such as trans and non-binary, and artists with disabilities. It is really important to me that the way I make my living by teaching Meisner music is not only affordable for all actors, but equitable to those who have faced disproportionate adversities in the arts. Last year, Meisner Music was able to begin offering a diversity and inclusion scholarship to a quarter of all of our spots in class. But being exclusive with the scholarship never felt right. Our goal for the fall is to be able to offer our diversity and inclusion scholarship to all singers who qualify, reducing the price of our classes by 40% for them. So while tonight is a free recital showcasing my work on this role, it is also a fundraiser for our Meisner in Music Diversity and Inclusion Scholarship students. Donations may be made to Jillian-Page on Venmo, and 100% of all the proceeds from tonight will benefit these diversity and inclusion students. So here's how tonight's gonna go. Our recital is gonna be a mix of pre-recorded videos that we couldn't do live and songs and scenes that we are able to do live. The cast and I have been recording these scenes and songs since April, and for each recording, we weren't just singing to a blank wall. We were actually on Zoom with each other and there for one another. We wanted these pre-recorded scenes to feel as live as possible. When you see us acting in them, we're really reacting off of the movies.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, I started recording, so whenever you guys are ready.
Oh, can you hear those children screaming in the background? Okay.
All right, finally, a huge thanks to my husband, Wesley Curtis, who edited every single one of these videos you're gonna see tonight. He put all of our videos... So cute. He put all of our videos together, added captions, mixed the sound, and now he is, as you can see, in our bedroom running the show tonight like a little magician. So, Wes, thank you for your invaluable help. We definitely couldn't have done the show without you. Finally, thank you all from the bottom of my heart for coming. This is going to be such a special night. Oh, so grab your glass, whatever you want to drink, cuddle up, and please enjoy our recital of The Most Happy Fella following the role of Rosabella. Our story begins in January of 1927 in San Francisco. We find ourselves at a restaurant at the time, watching a waitress from Texas bemoans her job as she closes the shop.
My feet, my poor, poor feet. Bet your life a waitress earns her pay. Having on my feet, my poor, poor feet, all day long today. My toes, my poor, poor toes. How can I give a service with a smile? Having on my toes, my poor, poor toes, mile after mile after mile after mile after mile. This little piggy's only broken. This little piggy's on the bum. This little piggy's in the middle. Consequently, absolutely numb. And this little piggy holds the weight of the plate, though the freight's just an order of Melba toast. And this little piggy is the littlest little piggy, but the big son of a bitch hurts the most. Ooh, my feet, my poor, poor feet. Better life awaits, returns her pay. Having on my feet, my poor, poor feet, all day long today. Doing my blue plate special ballet. Cleo's friend, another waitress at the restaurant, enters and gets hit on by their sleazy cashier, whom she swiftly rejects.
Me. I am not going out with that slimy slob.
I know how it is. Don't tell me. I know how it is. When you're number 27 on his list, being kissed, it's not exactly being.
I mean, I guess I've helped a few fellows prove they were fellows, but they were guys that I liked.
I know how it
they
is.
They thought I was something special.
Don't tell me. I know how it is. When you're
they
just 27
nice.
In his book, getting took out is not exactly being took.
Cleo, what do you think a customer left me?
I know how it is. Don't tell me I know how it is.
What do you think he left?
7 million crumbs in the gravy spot. Teaspoon suck in the mustard pot. Napkin on the floor. Ashes in the cup. And one Canadian dime. So you pick it up. With the 7 million crumbs and the
it's jewelry.
Huh?
He left me a piece of jewelry. It's a man's tie pin.
Well, it looks like amethyst. Must be glass. What'd he look like?
I don't remember anybody.
Well, didn't you see him? Didn't he talk to you?
No. I mean, the place was so busy tonight. You know me, I never remember a face or listen to a voice. I just hand him the menu. Hey. On it. Oh, it's a mash note. It's in a kind of funny broken English.
Honey, I think I better walk you home tonight.
My dear Rosabella.
Rosabella?
That's me. I call you Rosabella because I don't know your name. And I am too scared to ask.
This is what this place is always need, a bashful customer.
I cannot leave you money on the table. You look too nice. And so I leave you my genuine amethyst tie.
See, I wonder if it is real. Say, maybe a hawk shop would give you $100 for it. Have you ever seen a $100 bill? Back home in Dallas, they're known as Texas calling cards.
Cleo, it doesn't matter if the stone is real because... this is real. I shouldn't have made fun of it. It's a real love letter. Listen to what he says.
I don't know nothing about you, where you ever go, what you ever done. I don't know nothing about you. I don't want to know. I don't gotta know what I see. Is kind of that. I don't know nothing about you, wherever you go, wherever you don't know, I see this kind of young lady, I wanna get married. Yeah, I live on the Grape Ranch with my sister, RFD 11, Napa Valley. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, my name is Antonio Esposito.
Please send me a postcard just to say hello, and you make me very happy. Yours truly. Tommy.
Tommy.
That's a nice name.
Oh,
to get this damn coat lining fixed. Seems like in Dallas you didn't need a coat lining. Seems like you never needed anything. I should have just stayed there and married that chiropodist. Say, you ever know what they call that fuzzy little gray stuff at the bottom of your pocket? You know what they call it? It's called GNRR. G-N-R-R. Or some people like to call it Smurgles. S-M. Well, I don't know how to spell that. Gets in men's trousers cuffs too. Nobody knows where it's come from. Fella back home has it in a cigar box. Say, honey, what's the matter with you?
Maybe he's kind of crazy. This young fella. This young fella. But I'm gonna send him his postcard saying thank you. Yours sincerely, Rosabella.
He could be some kind of Rasputin or a small town Jack the Ripper to start with. He's a lunatic of a tipper. Now how about going home?
We've been going home every night, Cleo, kind of wanting something. But wanting what?
Wanting to soak my feet. Now come on, dream girl.
Wanting to be wanted, needing to be needed.
Fast forward to 3 months later. It is April in Napa Valley, California. Tony, the author of Rosabella's letter at the restaurant, enters elated because she has not only written back to him, but included a picture of herself and asks for a picture of him in return. However, Tony's wet blanket of a sister, Marie, discourages Tony, telling him that he is old, dumb, and ugly, and that Rosabella wouldn't want him if he sent his picture. As Tony toils over this, Joe, Tony's ruggedly handsome foreman, approaches him. Hey, boss, I've been looking for you. I got a... Hey, what's the matter with you? You don't look so good.
That's all right. I might not look so good.
Well, I don't want to add to your troubles, but I guess I'll be quitting the job soon, boss. See, I just got me a travel bag.
When you want to go, Joe?
Yeah, maybe 2 weeks, maybe a month. You're not sore, are you? You can find a new foreman. Me, I'm getting restless. You know me. If it wasn't you were such a great guy to me, I wouldn't have stuck with you this long. But now, it must be spring or something. I don't know. Every night I kind of feel it in the wind. When I drop into my bunk and blow out the light. Like a perfumed woman,
wind blows in the bunkhouse like a perfumed woman, smelling of where she's been, smelling of Oregon cherries, or maybe Texas avocado, or maybe Arizona sugar beet. The wind blows in, and she sings to me, 'cause I'm one of the rambling kids. She sings, Joey, 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 Joe. You've been too long in one place, and it's time to go, time to go, Joey, Joey, Joey. Joey, travel on. You've been too long in one town, and the harvest time come and gone. That's what the wind sings to me when the bunk I've been bunking in gets to feeling too soft and cozy, when the grub they've been cooking me gets to tasting too good, when I've had all I want of the ladies in the neighborhood. She sings, Joey, 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 Joe. You've been too long in one place, and it's time to go, time to go, Joey, Joey, Joe.
Watching Joe has given Tony an idea. Joe, listen, soon you're gonna leave me, Joe. You're going to pick somebody else as a crop far away.
What's gotten into you, boss? Ain't that kind of, you know, sentimental talk?
Soon you're gonna leave me, Joe. Every morning when I'm awake up, I want to see a pitch of the best damn foreman who ever come to work for me. My young Joe, young handsome Joe.
Why, sure. Tony, I don't mind.
That's a good.
Well, that was easy.
Grazie, Joe, grazie. And listen, Joe, anytime you want to quit the job, it's all right with me. I'm no get mad. I'm no want to stop you. You just, like you say, disappear, eh?
Well, thanks, boss. That's nice of you. I'll see you up at the ranch.
Well, heeding his sister's words that Rosabella would reject him if he sent her his own picture, Tony resolves to send her Joe's picture instead.
A few weeks later, Rosabella is arriving in Napa Valley to meet Tony. The whole town is excitedly preparing for Rosabella's arrival. However, Tony hasn't quite figured out the details of his trickery with sending her the wrong picture. When Tony realizes that Joe hasn't left town yet, he leaves for the train station to pick Rosabella up in an agitated hurry. Unbeknownst to him, though, Rosabella has already been picked up and brought into town by the postman.
Though initially miffed at being called a mail-order bride by the postman and overwhelmed by the raucous greeting of the townspeople, when Rosabella sees Joe, her mood suddenly shifts.
Such friendly faces all around me. Here I am, and look what I found in me. Friendly faces all around. I'm sorry I got mad. I'm sorry I got sore. You see, I've never been a mail order bride before. But now I'm happy I'm who I am, and I'm happy you're who you are, and I'm happy today is the day. Oh gosh, haven't you got something to say? Tell me, aren't you glad? I mean, you know I'm here beside you, dear. That is, aren't you glad? I mean, glad I came. You know, came to share your name. I thought I'd be settling for a place to hang my hat. Fourth three square meals a day, some good fresh air, and that was that. But this is much nicer and sweeter and warmer. Tell me, aren't you glad? I mean, glad I'm here. You know, here beside you. Tony,
dear. Tony? I'm not Tony, I'm Joe.
You're not Tony?
No, I'm Joe.
Well, thank you very much. It's been charming. Wait, let me ask you something. If this isn't you, then who is it?
It's me. All right. Yep, it's me. All right. I guess he must have sent you my picture instead of his.
Well, why would anybody do that?
Oh, wow. Why, the foxy grandpa. Oh, that foxy grandpa.
He's an old man. Isn't he? He's an old man.
Tony is a wonderful fella. Hey, look over there. That's Tony's friends come to meet you. How many guys you know got a yard full of friends? Yeah? Tony's a great fella. Couldn't you tell from his letters?
What do you know about his letters?
I mean, well, I helped him write a few of them. Spelling, you know, him being a foreigner.
You read my letters?
Yeah, some.
Oh, I'm getting out of here.
Yeah, Tony's a fine feller. Just you wait till you see.
Oh, I'm not waiting to see. Not on your life. I'm not going to stay here and be made a fool of.
Sorry you wasted all that time dreaming about me.
Yeah, be sure and tell all your friends.
Suddenly, a scream is heard. Two truck drivers arrive with his limp body. A crowd gathers, and the drivers tell everyone that in this hurry to get to the train station, Tony's truck overturned three times.
Bewildered and with nowhere to turn, Rosabella asks the truck drivers for a ride back to the station, but they tell her that they're headed the opposite way.
Weak and in pain, Tony feebly asks to marry Rosabella on the spot. The doctor tells Rosabella he's not sure how much time Tony has left.
With the pressure of the crowd watching her and the assumption that Tony may not even make it, Rosabella agrees to marry him in an impromptu ceremony, much to Tony's sister Marie's chagrin.
After the ceremony, Joe sits dejectedly on Tony's porch, realizing that he won't be able to leave as soon as he'd wanted now that Tony's incapacitated and will need help on the ranch.
Newly married Rosabella comes out onto the porch as well, humiliated and lost.
Tony sure is a fine feller, with the strength of a giant and the soul of a saint.
I want him leaving all over me.
With the strength of a giant and the smile
of a baby. Strength of a giant, an old man, an old man. I want him breathing all over me.
Don't cry. Don't cry, come on back to the house, and don't cry, come on back to the house, and get out from under that cold, old sky.
After a few moments of trying to resist this unexpected romantic tension between them, Joe and Rosabella find themselves in a passionate embrace. They both look up to Tony's house guiltily and then walk off stage together, concluding act one. Esteban, you'll have to leave and come back. It's doing that thing again. Oh wait, never mind, try it again.
Act two begins a week later in Tony's vineyards. Everyone is hard at work, including Rosabella and Joe, who regard each other awkwardly. Every day for a week now.
Here he comes every day since a week ago.
And the best we can do, is nod.
Good morning.
I'll never know why
I'll never know how.
It didn't matter then. It's cold,
cold,
cold, and dead, dead and buried, buried and gone, gone, forgotten, far away,
far away, and dead.
And now every day the best we can do is nod good morning.
Tony and his doctor enter, having a heated discussion about Tony's recovery from his accident, lasting a whopping 12 weeks, leaving him unable to walk. Tony asks his doctor, what's the use of trying to recover when he has nothing to live for? His doctor encourages him that love and kindness will cure Tony's ailments. Doubtful that his affection will be well received after some awkward previous encounters, Tony approaches Rosabella. He apologizes to her for sending the wrong guy's picture and explains that, well, he didn't think she would come had he sent him his own.
We're friends now, huh? We start all over again. I'ma meet you for the first time. Hello.
Well, when you meet somebody for the first time, there are special things you're supposed to say, which you may not mean, but they sound polite as can be. Would you like to learn them?
Gee.
Acquaintance. Let me say the pleasure
is mine. The pleasure, she's mine.
How do you do? Please to know
you. You do, please to know
and
you.
Oh, my English is poor.
My English is goddamn poor. Happy to make you acquaintance.
Won't you please say likewise?
Look wise.
No, likewise.
Like a wish.
No, likewise.
Oh, likewise, I'm sure.
Expect to see me.
Surprise!
Wait, what happened? Why is she here?
Oh, I send for her. I give her job pasting labels on my grape boxes.
No walk-in, it's in my contract.
That's right. Sit down all day.
All day. Oh, man. Gosh, I am so glad to see you.
Oh, and me you.
Oh, that's a new outfit. Turn around.
Oh, you like it?
And what did you do to your hair?
I rinsed it in the Friday special.
Good. Now you got the company. Why you know how you say, introduce me?
Oh, yeah, I'm so sorry. Cleo, this is Tony.
How are you?
How I am? Happy to make you acquainted.
Feeling better after the accident?
Thank you so much. I'm feel fine.
Certainly nice to meet you.
Happy to make you acquaintance.
It's a pleasure.
And might I say the pleasure. She's mine.
He's cute.
How do you do? Pleased to know you.
And so polite, too.
And oh, my English is a poor.
Your English suits me fine.
Happy to make you acquaintance.
Now, won't you please say likewise?
Look a wise.
No, likewise.
Like a waste.
No, likewise.
Oh, likewise, I'm sure. That's my sister Marie up there.
Oh, I'll be happy to make her acquaintance.
Whoa, she catch on a quick, no?
I'll go get cleaned up. I'll see you later.
Hey, tell me something. Why did you send for Cleo?
I'm think maybe you was a lonesome.
Oh.
So I'm a send for a friend you tell me about.
You know something? I'm not so lonesome. I guess I kind of like it here.
That's nice.
And you know something else? You're a nice, kind man.
How do you do? I'm pleased to know you. And oh, my English is a poor. Happy to make you acquaintance.
Now, won't you please say likewise?
Look wise.
No, likewise.
Oh, likewise.
No, likewise.
Oh, likewise, I'm sure.
A few weeks go by, and we find ourselves in Tony's vineyard later in May. Tony and Rosabella have continued to find a connection within their budding friendship. Tony's sister Marie, however, is doing everything she can to break up her brother and Rosabella from gaining closeness. For this quartet, I will be singing the role of Tony's agitated sister Marie as we settle in on a blissful scene in the vineyard, wondering with Tony and Rosabella how these days have gone by so fast.
The days, they come and go. Lunedì,
Lunedì.
With things going well between Tony and Rosabella, grumpy old Marie continues to try and break them up. She angrily approaches her brother Tony and tells him that young people want to be free and unattached from old people like him. Marie then leaves Tony, befuddled and depressed. In the wake of this upset, Rosabella approaches Tony.
Immediately after this, Rosabella is whisked away by her friends, and Tony is left with his fear that what his sister Marie has said is right, that his lot in life is to grow old while Rosabella's is to live. A month later, we see that Tony's recovery is going really well and that he's begun to walk again. However, Rosabella is growing frustrated that her words of love still haven't seemed to have landed with Tony.
Well, isn't it wonderful? The doctor's got him on his feet and teaching him to walk again.
Wish he'd teach him to walk toward me.
Well, what's the matter with you, honey?
Nothing. Nothing at all. It's just that...
What is it? I love him. I love him.
He treats me like a baby. He doesn't seem to understand. I love him. And he treats me like a kid.
I know how it is. Tell me, I know how it is. All the modesty and shyness at the start kind of work the way into your little heart.
Not that we're married or anything. I mean, he's my husband, isn't he?
I know how it is. Don't tell me. I know how it is. All the bashful ways that seem so very right, they turn out to be the things you gotta fight.
Oh, I love it. Yes, I love the way he looks and smiles and feels.
Don't tell me, kid. Tell him exactly how. And as they say in a musical comedy, here he comes now.
Let me sit down. What's the use of walk? I ain't going no place. Hey, Rosabella, What's the matter? You look at me like you was saying... So nice.
And you treat me like a baby. You just don't seem to understand.
What, Rosabella? What?
A woman loves a man. That's how I love you.
Rosabella, non just say what you know me. Rosabella, a quanto sono contento. Cosa ti posso dire? Tu mi stai a cuore. What can I say? What can I say? My heart is so full of you, so full of you. He's got no room for anything else in there. Rosabella, you make me a man. Crazy like fire, crazy with love, crazy with love. A sono contento, sono contento to the sky at cuore. When my heart is so full of you, so full of you, he's got no room, no room in my heart for anything more. Carissima, I want to tell everybody, everybody in the whole beautiful world, tonight we have a sposalizio. Everybody come and then I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna make a speech. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm gonna throw this party today to make big announcement. My wife, she's a love me now. My wife, she's a love me now. My wife, she's a fall in love with me.
Finally on the same page, Tony and Rosabella throw together a wedding reception to celebrate their marriage properly after several months since their impromptu ceremony at Tony's accident.
The whole town arrives at Tony's vineyard and the celebration is going strong when Rosabella faints. A doctor whisks her away and they find privately that she is pregnant with Joe's baby.
Somberly, the doctor and Rosabella rejoin the wedding celebration. The doctor suggested the guests that they give Tony and Rosabella some time alone.
Carissima, what's the matter? You ain't dressed for the party.
Tony, I'm not going to be at any party.
What?
Tony, listen to me. I've got to tell you something, something terrible.
Non you tell me nothing terrible, Rosabella.
I'm going away. I'm leaving here.
You go away?
When I tell you what happened, it's going to hurt you something awful.
What? Rosabella, where you go?
When I tell you the truth, you'll throw me out anyhow.
The truth? What's the matter? What's that happened?
Tony, I'm going to have a baby.
Of course I did.
I'm going to have a baby. I had to tell you the truth. I guess I could have just run away, but I...
Who? Who?
Joe.
Dio mio!
It just happened, that's all. It was crazy.
You've been a Joe's a woman.
It was crazy.
You've been going into the bed with a Joe.
No, it didn't mean anything to me, I swear. I haven't even talked to him since that night.
At night.
Our wedding night. It happened the night we were here.
God damn you!
Here's the type in back. When you left it for me, it meant you trusted me and I wasn't worth it. Please let me tell you that I love you. Just one more time before I go. Please let me tell you that I love you, 'cause it happens to be so. How I've hurt you, and how you must hate me, I know. Oh God, I know. Once she's told Tony the truth about her pregnancy, Rosabella heads to the Napa train station to leave town and start a new life alone.
After Tony's confession, well, Tony wonders to himself, where will Rosabella go? Where will she have her baby? In the street? His heart softens for her as he realizes that she could have left him without telling him the truth. Determined to stop Rosabella from leaving, Tony heads to the train station.
Hot on his trail, Tony's sister, Marie, arrives at the station soon after Tony. She desperately tries to tell her brother that no one will ever love him like she does. When Tony ignores her, Marie takes his cane from him, leaving the still crippled Tony staggering to the ground.
Well, Cleo has had enough. She throws herself at Marie to get Tony's cane back and defend him. Terrified, Marie gets the picture and runs away once and for all.
As the train conductor begins to put Rosabella's suitcase on the train, Tony motions for him to stop, and he approaches Rosabella.
He's gonna be Tony's bambino. We tell everybody he's a Tony's bambino, and then everybody say, oh, Tony's so goddamn young and strong. He break all of his bones, and he still have a baby just the same. Who's gonna know? Who?
You'll know. You'll know, and you'll hate me, and you'll hate the baby.
Nunca be scared, carissima. It's so bad to be scared. Me, Tony, I was scared one night last springtime. I'm scared to drive down to the station to meet my Rosabella. I'm a scared. I'm a too old. I'm a talk fun. I'm a drive too fast and I have accidente. Maybe that same night in the springtime you was a scared too. And you have accidente. I'm scared all the time. I'm scared because I send you wrong fellas a pitch. The young, handsome fellas pitch. Before that, I seen you in the ristorante in Frisco. I should have not left a sneaky little note on the bill of fare. I should have knew what I say and say it. Now tonight, we start all over. I sit in ristorante in Frisco, and you wait on me. I tell me, excuse me, a younger lady. What's your name?
Amy.
That's a nice name. I cannot leave you money on the table. You look too nice. And so I give you my genuine amethyst typing.
How can you be so good to me? How can you be so kind after what I did?
I don't know. Nothing about you, where you ever go. I don't know nothing about you. I don't gotta know. I don't wanna know. All I see is kind of young lady. I wanna get married. My wife, she's a love.
What other plan can I have?
My wife, she's a love.
What other plan can I have?
My wife, she's a thorn.
What other dream can I dream
with me?
When
my heart is so full of you, so full of you. He got no room, no room in my heart.
So we tried to record this huge finale as a four-person quartet, and here's what happened.
Second take. The
finale. Most happy.
Finale, the most happy. That's gonna be interesting.
Happy.
I couldn't do that with a straight face.
Most happy man.
No.
Most happy man.
That was good though, Tony. You came in right.
So instead, we're going to bow to the original Broadway cast of this glorious finale. Thank you so much for joining us. Donate if you feel so called and have a wonderful night.